DROS. It's not a real word. It's an acronym made from the first letters of the phrase Date of Expected Return from Overseas. It is the date every American in Vietnam burned deeply into his or her memory. Personnel in Vietnam did not go home. They did not rotate. They did not leave. They DROS'd. Unfortunately, more than 58,000 women and men did not live to see the morning of their DROS. The stories they could have told about their experiences in Vietnam were never heard and are lost forever. Today, over 40 years later, as Vietnam veterans move out of their 60s into and through their 70s and 80s, their stories could also be lost. To date, the stories about American involvement in the Vietnam War have focused mainly on the actions of the combat units of the Army, Marines, Navy, Air Force, and the Special Forces. There are other groups of veterans whose contributions to and sacrifices for the war effort lay, for the most part, hidden from the collective American knowledge about the war. They have received little attention in the writings of historians and academics or the works of the documentary producers. This is my story about one of these groups, the Mobile Advisory Teams, or as we call them, MAT Teams. It comes from my experiences as a member of a MAT team in Vietnam in 1971. It is about our origins, our training, our mission, and how we were deployed throughout Vietnam. Before my story begins, some background would be helpful. America's first involvement in Vietnam began as advisors to the Army of the Republic of Vietnam, which we called the ARVN. American combat units and their support elements were introduced into the conflict later. The Special Forces, or Green Berets, worked in the rural areas and jungles of Vietnam as advisors, trainers, and leaders to the local non-regular forces called the Civilian Irregular Defense Groups, or the CIDG. By 1967, some of the combat units began to experiment with deploying small groups of soldiers with the local security forces in the areas in which they operated. These soldiers trained and advised the District Regional Force Companies, or the RF, as they were called, and the Hamlet-based Popular Force Platoons, or PF, in order to improve local security and to gather intelligence about the Viet Cong. The result of the work of these small units impressed MACV, the Military Assistance Command Vietnam, that was in charge of the war effort. The result was the development of an in-country course to train Mobile Advisory Teams, or MAT teams. By the end of 1967, there were over 350 MAT teams deployed throughout Vietnam, living with and training the local security forces. The Tet Offensive in January 1968 marked the changing point in the war. Throughout South Vietnam, local and main force Viet Cong and the North Vietnamese Army, or NVA, launched coordinated attacks against the major cities, military bases, and the rural camps and outposts of the regional force companies and popular force platoons. After a month of intense fighting, the Viet Cong and the NVA were badly defeated. In many places, the regional force companies, or RF, and the popular force platoons, or PF, held their own in the fighting. This demonstrated the value of having MAT teams live with the Vietnamese to organize and train and fight with the rough puffs, another term used to refer to the regional and popular forces. Overall, Tet was a military success for American, ARVN, RF, and PF forces, but it changed the mindset of the American people. American support, having been divided into camps that were either for or against the war, shifted heavily towards opposition. Responding to this, Congress and the White House began to reduce funding levels under a plan named Vietnamization. The Pentagon started withdrawing American units to reduce both troop levels and direct combat involvement in the war. Troop reduction hit the Special Forces. This map shows the deployment of Special Forces in Three Corps in the mid-1960s. The C team supported the B teams that were in the provinces. B teams in turn supported the 12-man A teams, shown in blue, that were stationed at vital points throughout the districts within the provinces. As Vietnamization proceeded, these teams were withdrawn or significantly reduced in number. This left much, if not all, of the advising of the regional and popular force units to the MAT teams. By the end of 1968, more than 400 MAT teams were deployed in Vietnam. The mobile advisory teams were composed of five men. The team leader was a captain, and the assistant team leader was a first lieutenant. The team had a heavy weapons non-commissioned officer, or NCO, a light weapons NCO, and a medic. Training for MAT team members differed widely. Some members of MAT teams continued to be trained in country. Other MAT team members were trained stateside at the Military Assistance Training Advisor, or MATA, course that had been established at the U.S. Army Special Warfare Center at Fort Bragg, North Carolina. By 1971, the expanded 8-week MAT team training course, now called MAT Accords, included elements of Special Forces training and was taught in part by Green Berets. MAT Accords training, some of it classified, was intense. It included numerous topics taught both in the classroom and in the field. From there, some MAT team personnel were sent to the Defense Language Institute West, or DLI, at Biggs Field, Fort Bliss, in El Paso, Texas, for 3 months of intensive Vietnamese language training taught by Vietnamese nationals. Like the A-teams, MAT teams lived in the camps and outposts with their Vietnamese counterparts. They were not co-located with American combat forces and did not return to American base camps at night. Some MAT teams were based at former Special Forces camps that provided a reasonable measure of security. Other MAT teams were located in much more vulnerable positions, so they made sure never to sleep in the same place 2 nights in a row, making it more difficult for the Viet Cong to find them. From camps and outposts scattered in the jungles of rural Vietnam, these advisors and their RF and PF units continued to bring the war directly to the local force and main force Viet Cong. Contact was frequent. Some teams reported almost daily encounters with Viet Cong. Fighting was often bloody but rarely decisive. The Viet Cong would fade back into the jungle only to reemerge tomorrow. Many MAT teams were far from other units and for the most part on their own. Help, if needed, was distant and could be a long time coming, especially on a rainy, moonless night. While it is hard to document, some reports indicate that a significant number of teams were lost, either killed or missing in action. I joined MAT 111 in May 1971 as the assistant team leader. I was a citizen soldier who had enlisted early in 1969. I went to basic training at Fort Dix, advanced infantry training in Tigerland at Fort Polk, and Infantry Officers Candidate School at Fort Benning. After training troops at Fort Campbell for 6 months, I was ordered to Fort Bragg for training at MAT Accords, Fort Bliss, Biggs Field for DLI, and then to Vietnam. MAT 111 was an element of Advisory Team 67 that was based in Phuoc Long Province, north of Saigon. MAT 111 was co-located with the Don Luan District Advisory Team at the village of Dong Xoai. The camp had been built by one of the Navy's construction battalions, or Seabees, in 1965, and for a time was the home of Special Forces A-Team 342. The District Advisory Team consisted of 4 men. The District Senior Advisor, or DSA, was an Armor Major. His NCO was an Infantry Staff Sergeant. The intelligence group consisted of a military intelligence captain and sergeant. The current MAT team leader, or Air Defense Artillery Captain, had arrived in November 1970, 6 months before me. Shortly after I arrived, the team's 2 NCOs derosed. 2 NCOs from another MAT in province that was being deactivated replaced them. The team leader had developed a very good rapport with the district officials. This became invaluable when the district senior advisor was medevaced for a medical emergency and not replaced. The MAT leader became the de facto DSA, and the rest of the team carried on with the day-to-day MAT duties. Throughout 1971, MAT 111 maintained a very intense advising effort, working at many levels within the village and hamlets. We worked with other Advisory Team 67 advisors and the local leaders to organize projects such as draining stormwater and other wet areas to aid mosquito control. And constructing sewage systems. We helped the people qualify for grants of money and equipment, and to establish small businesses. Occasionally, we accompanied a villager to Saigon or Benoit to pick up grant money. Our presence assured that the villager would not have to bribe a government official. We work with the province agriculture advisor to introduce a new variety of rice to the farmers. When possible, we secured helicopter evacuations for local civilian medical emergencies. Militarily, our work had many aspects. With province coordination, we work with American Army aviation units as observers in single-engine airplanes called O-1 Berg Dogs, looking for signs of cross-border infiltration from Cambodia and local force Viet Cong activity. We also work with pink teams. Pink team is an interesting name for a strategy that used two attack helicopters called Cobras and one unarmed light observation helicopter called a Loach. The Loach would fly very low over the jungle to draw enemy ground fire. Then the Cobras would swoop in to destroy the source of the ground fire. We flew as observers in the Loach because rules of engagement required that permission for American units to engage the enemy in the district had to come from either the leader or the assistant MAT team leader. Another rule that we had to observe was that we could not expend ordnance and to actively maintain rubber plantations. We continued to work and train the Hamlet Security Forces called the People's Self-Defense Force, or PSDF. The PSDF's job was to resist any incursion by the Viet Cong until the nearby PF platoon could come to their aid. We were able to update some of their vintage World War I weapons with weapons from World War II. We maintained the training of the Regional Force Company and the Popular Force platoons in the district, and we accompanied the RF companies on combat patrols throughout the district, searching for local force Viet Cong and gathering evidence of cross-border infiltration from Cambodia. We coordinated security sweeps of the district roads to ensure safety from Viet Cong ambushes, mines, and booby traps. Unlike the A-teams that often led their units, we were no longer in command. We were there strictly as advisors to offer advice and help when needed and to coordinate support for artillery, airstrikes, and medevacs from American units. The Vietnamese leaders of the units were in command. The day-to-day operations for MAT teams could be difficult. The A-teams received all of their supports from their B and C teams. Our support originated with the Vietnamese. For example, our Jeeps. They were not signed out of an American motor pool. Upkeep and repairs were our responsibility. Tools and spare parts were not readily available. Our NCOs worked with what was at hand and kept us on the road. Throughout Vietnam, MAT team NCOs had reputations as good traders, often returning from excursions to American units with needed equipment and supplies. As the assistant team leader, I was responsible for ensuring the readiness of the team's equipment and maintaining the team's supply levels. I made it a point to never ask where a new part or crate of ammunition came from. I did not want to know. Our camp was on the edge of radio range. With our generator running, our more powerful radios could just reach province headquarters, but we could not run the generator 24 hours a day. Even with a long-range antenna, our portable field radios were too weak to communicate with our headquarters. When we were hit at night, someone had to go outside and start the generator. Combat operations were both offensive and defensive. At times, our losses were heavy. But the Viet Cong were repaid in kind. Local artillery support came from the district's two 105mm howitzers located at the camp. With a range of less than 12 kilometers or 7.5 miles, at times we found ourselves operating outside their reach. Using Vietnamese or borrowed American air assets, we mounted air mobile operations planned by province. One source of support we did rely on was Air America. We used their fixed-wing aircraft for transport north to team headquarters and south to Binh Duong, Saigon. While Air America could not provide us with gunship supports, we did use their Huey helicopters and emergencies for transport of personnel and resupply when American and Vietnamese assets were unavailable. Air America often flew in weather that grounded other helicopters. We operated in pairs in the field, one officer and one NCO. The medic remained at camp. As the advisors, my sergeant or I called for American air, artillery, and medevac support through province or whomever we could reach on the radio. But sometimes the radio was silent. On some operations, the only person we could communicate with was the province operation officer when he was overhead in a helicopter. For these reasons and others, there were occasions when it was a very lonely war. The drawdown of American forces eventually hit the MAT teams. By the beginning of November 1971, MAT 111's team leader and two NCOs had derosed and were not replaced. The team medic had been pulled back to province because Dong Xoai was considered too exposed. During the final weeks of my tour, I found myself assigned to missions with regional force units unknown to me in other districts with which I was unfamiliar. The second American, we operated in pairs for each mission, was a different NCO officer whose experience and training varied. To my knowledge, I was the only MAT team member remaining in province when I derosed in December 1971. That left only two advisors from the co-located district team at Dong Xoai, the district team NCO and the military intelligence captain. By sheer accident, I ran into that remaining district team NCO stateside about 10 years later. He told me that during the Easter Offensive in early 1972, the Viet Cong hit the camp with an estimated 400 rounds of heavy mortar fire and overran the camp with the aid of two North Vietnamese tanks. He and the intel captain managed to escape and evade and were picked up 2 days later in the jungle by a helicopter searching for survivors. Dong Xoai was retaken later in the year in part by the regional unpopular forces that had been driven out in the Easter attack, demonstrating that their training had not been lost, as shown in this excerpt from the 1972-73 Command History Volume 1. Recently, I discovered the website macvteams.org. This site has a webpage for every advising team in Vietnam. It contains comments, descriptions, questions, and answers among its team member. It also has inquiries from daughters, sons, brothers, and sisters seeking information on a relative who was killed or declared missing while assigned to the team. Some of the posts are difficult to read, but collectively they provide a very personal account of the activities of the advisors in all theaters of operation in Vietnam throughout the war. I do not claim that my experiences as the assistant team leader of MAT 111 were typical of other MAT teams. I seriously doubt it, since MAT teams were deployed throughout Vietnam in vastly differing situations. However, reading the comments from the members of the various MACV teams on the website reaffirms my belief that for many MAT teams, scattered far from other units, often on their own, out of radio communication, and with little or no immediate support available, it was a lonely war. Of a very lonely war. So where does this go now? Honestly, I do not know. attempts to date by articles, books, movies, television shows, and documentaries to explain to this country the tasks undertaken and the sacrifices made by the Americans involved in the war have been extremely limited in their scope and minimal in their impact based on what we see happening today. Even the Burns-Novick PBS Vietnam series, with its view on the effects of war on the peoples involved, did not have time to examine the advising efforts in detail. Since every MAT team member had a different experience, chronicling their stories into a cohesive presentation may be an impossible task. However, it is my sincere hope that more members of the MAT teams, as well as veterans who served in other unknown units, will recall their experiences and share them so they will not be lost. I hope that websites such as MACVteams.org and organizations such as the Veterans Breakfast Club that we have here in the Pittsburgh area will become available to all veterans as places where they can tell their stories. Ideally, some of their stories will begin to make it into the future writings of historians and academics so that the contributions, challenges, and the meaning of their service will not be lost to future generations, and will serve as a reminder to our military and political leaders of the varied and sometimes lonely experiences and of the prices paid by its soldiers, too many of whom did not live to see the morning of their deros. Otherwise, we will be committed to digging more graves, setting more markers, and etching more names on black granite walls.